Hello, welcome to our Sky Tonight program. This is Seth Mayo, curator of astronomy for the LOHMAN Planetarium. And in this episode, we're covering the dates of December 14th through December 20th. And there is a lot to talk about for this week. I'll start off with a total solar eclipse happening on Monday for our Southern Hemisphere friends. So we cannot see this in the Northern Hemisphere in most of the world. I want to talk about the Geminid meteor shower. The peak happened Sunday night, Monday morning, but we still have a chance to see more of them this week. And we're going to talk about the great conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn. This week, Jupiter and Saturn are getting closer and closer together. The moon will join by as well, which we'll take a look at. And this is all going to culminate to a very close conjunction of the two planets on the 21st, which hasn't been seen like this in hundreds of years. So very exciting times. Let's just dive right on in. As we began this episode, you probably noticed something odd with the sun here being partially covered by this dark disk. And that disk actually represents the new moon when the backside of the moon is being lit by the sun. Of course, in real life during the daytime, you would not see this. But Solarium is showing this because on Monday the 14th, there is a total solar eclipse occurring in the southern hemisphere. And that's when the Earth, Moon, and Sun line up in a straight line, which is called a syzygy. That happens to be one of my favorite words, by the way. And a syzygy can occur once in a while, and if you're in the right spot on Earth, your day can very briefly turn into night. And the moon's shadow is very skinny, only about 50, 60 miles wide, moves across the Earth very quickly, so you have to be in a very specific spot. And this map from NASA shows us that sliver of the Earth that you'd have to be in. And you'll notice two dark blue lines going across South America. That's where you'd have to be in within those two dark blue lines. This eclipse starts in the Pacific Ocean. It moves across in the morning into Chile and then into Argentina for greatest eclipse. That's when the moon's covering the sun most completely at 16, 13, and 22 seconds universal time. For us on the East Coast, that is 11, 13, and 22 seconds local time. And I have it actually set here. So this is the moment of greatest eclipse, at least for those in the southern hemisphere. And then it moves across, and this eclipse for them only lasts for about 2 minutes and 9 seconds, so it's a very brief moment, and then it moves across into the Atlantic Ocean. So what a sight they'll have down there. And I had a chance to see the great American eclipse in 2017 move across the west coast to the east coast. That was an amazing sight to see. And for those who are interested in another great opportunity for an eclipse, which will happen in 2024, April of that year, from Mexico all the way up through the U.S., kind of going northeast into the northeastern part of the United States and upward towards the north there. And so that map kind of shows you a nice kind of view of that for 2024. Of course, you can look up other eclipses that happen throughout the year from NASA or other websites as well if you want to plan in your area. So these events are great to follow, and hopefully they'll have a nice view down there in South America. Speaking of the new moon on the 14th, which caused a total solar eclipse in the southern hemisphere, that was a very convenient phase because it happened near the peak of the annual Geminid meteor shower. And with the new moon, you don't have extra light obscuring the meteor is shooting across the sky. And as I mentioned recently, this meteor shower emits out of an area near one of the heads of the twins. This is Pollux, and this star is Castor right here of the Gemini twins. And the radiant point is near the head of Castor that you see there. And that's where you'd see the meteors sort of radiate from, where you can trace them back from that area there, even though you can see the meteors across the entire sky. And in this area, just to give you a sense of where you're looking, this is near Orion the Hunter with the three stars of his belt and Taurus the Bull with the Pleiades star cluster. The later you stay up, the better it is because Gemini gets higher and higher up into a more favorable area of the sky. And even though we're past the actual peak of the shower, the peak may extend even into Monday night and even Tuesday morning, the 15th as well. And the meteor shower technically doesn't end until the 17th. So you still have more time to see the Geminids and maybe a pretty good show for Tuesday morning as well. Maybe the weather wasn't so good on Monday morning or Sunday night. So maybe Tuesday morning, even Monday evening, may be a better chance for you to see these and through the rest of the week as well. So hopefully you get to see a Geminid or two. Maybe you had a great show during the actual peak, and this is one of the best meteor showers all year. As I've mentioned in many past episodes this year, we have one of the greatest celestial events of 2020 and for many years is the conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn, these giant gas planets that are looking like they're close, at least from Earth's perspective, in our sky towards the southwest. And when Jupiter and Saturn are close, it's called a great conjunction. And this doesn't happen all the time. When Jupiter and Saturn get close, this actually happens every 20 years, but not every conjunction is the same. Some are a little farther apart than others. That's called the angular separation. And for this particular great conjunction, which actually happens next week on the 21st, that's actually the winter solstice as well, this angular separation is 0.1 degrees or a tenth of a degree. Another way to put it, it's a fifth of a full moon's width. That's very, very close. So you should see two little objects close together, but it's going to be amazing to see them. And you'll notice they're very low in the southwest. So this week, you're going to see them get closer and closer to each other. We're going to zoom in just a little bit here, just to give us a better view. You can see I have them labeled here. Jupiter is going to be the brighter one to the bottom, and Saturn is a little bit less dim. There's going to look like two stars that don't twinkle. As I've mentioned before, planets look like non-twinkling stars. And as we continue to move through the week, the separation between these two planets gets smaller and smaller. And even on Monday the 14th, Jupiter and Saturn are pretty close. But as we move through time, let's see what happens. So let's go to Tuesday the 15th. You'll see them even closer together. On Wednesday the 16th, the very thin crescent moon joins the scene for a really nice view. And even on the 17th, on that Thursday, you'll find the moon still close by, a little bit above the two planets and to the left. And so if you're a photographer, this is a great opportunity to get a really nice planetary scene that doesn't happen all the time. Even through a cell phone camera, you might catch something interesting, or your naked eyes. You don't even need any equipment at all. Just to take it in with your own eyes is totally worth it. Now keep in mind, this is all happening kind of very near sunset. I have the time set to about 6:15 Eastern time here. And so you do have to compete a little bit with the sun's glare. And as we do move through the week, Jupiter and Saturn will descend a little bit more into the glare. And so you have a little bit less time to see it, but enough time to enjoy the scene. So you have a very clear and unobstructed view of the southwest. That should give you a really nice scene to take in. And as we move through the week here, even more, we'll go to the 18th, which you'll see the moon even higher up by then. And then by the weekend on the 19th and the 20th is when Jupiter and Saturn really zero in on each other for the 21st that happens on Monday, when they're the closest they've been for hundreds of years, which is great. Now, don't worry if the weather does not cooperate on the 21st, because as you see here, the dates around the 21st are still decent for seeing these two planets so close to each other. So if one particular date doesn't work out, don't worry, you have a series of dates around the 21st to see the planets very, very close to one another, which is really nice. Now, another way to enjoy this conjunction is if you have binoculars or a telescope, which would allow you to see these objects in close proximity. So in this more magnified view, which we're simulating now, this is on Wednesday the 16th, when they're already very close to each other, and we'll continue to move ahead in time to the 17th and to the 18th as they continue to near each other here. And then by the weekend, on the 19th and 20th, they are so, so close, as you see here. We're going to go all the way to the 21st on Monday of next week for the closest they'll get for this great conjunction here, a tenth of a degree. And if you zoom in even more here, we can get a better view. So this is depending on if you have a certain type of magnification or eyepiece that allows you to see much more than just the planets. You can see Jupiter here and Saturn with its rings, but their moons as well, which is really cool. And so with Jupiter, you have the four Galilean moons that you find here. Jupiter's four largest and brightest moons, Callisto, Io, Ganymede, and Europa. These are four moons out of 79 moons discovered around Jupiter. We make our way to Saturn here, and you may have a chance to see maybe Titan, Iapetus here. Saturn also has many moons as well. And so to see this through the scope is so, so cool. Even through a small telescope, it is possible. And astrophotographers out there, I'm sure, are going to be taking pictures of this, taking video of this, and watching this scene unfold, which is going to be great to see all those pictures online. I hope to take pictures of this each night up into the 21st. And so hopefully I can get something interesting to share here. And what's amazing is these moons move very quickly, and Jupiter and Saturn spin very quickly as well. And so they can change quite dramatically through the night, which really shows you the dynamic kind of changing nature of this. And it's a cool way to see the solar system sort of play out right in front of you. And so that's always cool as well. So I'm sure you'll see some people catch really cool time-lapse or video of these objects sort of moving around each other in interesting ways. And don't worry if you don't have any type of device. I'm sure online there are going to be observatories and facilities streaming this at some point so you can see this yourself. So there's going to be some way to view this conjunction through a telescope if you don't have one of those yourselves. But even just a good pair of binoculars, it's amazing what you can see with those. So as you can see here, this is a really awesome celestial opportunity to take advantage of, something that doesn't happen very often. And the next time you'll see these planets this close is the year 2080. So definitely take advantage of our 2020 viewing opportunity here. And one thing I just want to mention here at the end is that you should be able to see two separate objects with your naked eyes. It does depend on your eyesight and the atmospheric conditions where you're looking in the southwest, but for normal vision, you should see two separate things. So it should look like a little double planet going on there, which is pretty cool to know that they're Jupiter and Saturn. And in next week's episode, I'm gonna talk about this occurrence and when it happened last time, and when it's gonna happen in the future and what that will actually look like. So we'll kind of go back and forward in time a little bit talking about this for next week's episode when this conjunction actually occurs. So stay tuned. Hey, that's it for another edition of our Sky Tonight. Thanks again for tuning in. And as always, stop by the LOHMAN Planetarium if you're in Daytona Beach to watch a show safely. We're doing live shows every single day, so hope to see you there at some point. And with that, hope you tune in again for more coverage of the sky and especially this great conjunction. So watch our social media, watch all our channels, and thank you again. Take care, happy stargazing, and happy conjunction viewing.